evening, everybody. My name is Simon Wright. I am the Director of Product here at Japan House London, and welcome to today's event, Collecting and Collectors, a talk and a question and answer session with Asian art in London. Casting live from Japan House in front of an audience here in the hall, and to a live virtual audience on Zoom, and the event is being recorded. And recording will be archived on social media platforms. So tonight's event celebrates the 25th anniversary of the art in London, and complements our special display, the Art of Collecting, which can be found on the ground floor here in Japan House. The display features selected items from the collection of 9 participants, including fine examples of ceramics, ubushi, lacquerware, woodblock prints, and throughout the evening, we shall enjoy 3 short presentations of esteemed Japanese collectors and curators in the world of Japanese art and design. We are grateful to all of us to create a specially themed evening at Japan. Thank you very much indeed. But for the speakers, welcome to guests of Zoom. So if you are watching on Zoom, please do use the Zoom question and answer function. So without further ado, let me first introduce. This is Simon Pilling. He is director of on 20th century artistic development and the work of contemporary art ensures the continuation of Japan's rich artistic tradition. His primary focus and passion relates to urushi, Japanese lacquer. And during his presentation, Simon will discuss the development of collecting Japanese artwork outside Japan, the process and the motivation, focusing on Japanese lacquer.
in the early 1600s, before 1607, and in the collection of the Habsburg Archduke Ferdinand II, and probably given to him by his father, the Holy Roman Emperor Ferdinand I. Another typical item of the time that the Portuguese were commissioning was the domed coffer. And we see these still coming into the marketplace in auctions. But it is a form that is so alien to the Japanese that they had to invent a name for it, because they had never seen anything like it. And they called it the Kamaboku Gata, meaning a fish in a box in fish sausage shape, which is a very difficult thing to say. But an extraordinary sort of name for this completely alien product, which these Europeans were saying they wanted made. But it's not just the forms of these pieces that were alien to the Japanese, it's the decoration. I mean, yes, it's got maquillé on it, you can see the gold, and it's got a lot of mother of pearl inlay, which you can see in these geometric patternings. So it's very, very lavish. But it's very much not Japanese. It's imagery and patterning much more closely connected with India or with Korea and European geometric patterning. So thus we have a unique style, which is combining an indigenous and non-Japanese decorative and technical feature. And it was made to commission to appeal to the Western lifestyle. It was an exotic market. As well as exporting to Europe, these items are known to have been shipped to the Americas, to the Portuguese and Spanish colonies in Southern America. And to this day, you can find pieces like this turning up in that country. So lacquer's first reception in the West focused on very high-end objects that entered the households of the rich and the powerful, but the interest was not in Japan or its unique indigenous lacquer objects. It was an exploitation of the potential of the medium of lacquer to create the uniquely opulent finish that we see in objects like this. But by the beginning of the 17th century, the fortunes of the Spanish and Portuguese were declining. And it was a decline hastened in Japan, probably by the unwelcome, in Japanese eyes, missionary ambitions of the Portuguese and Spanish in introducing Christianity to Japan, such that trading with Portugal and Spain decreased, and another nation was appearing to take that position, the Dutch, in the shape of the Dutch East India Company. And from about 1610, it too started commissioning lacquer items, which it's recorded as being observed as being very expensive, exceedingly beautiful, and requiring enormous time and technical skill to produce. And contemporary records of the time in the early 1600s tell of the harbors of Amsterdam and Rotterdam becoming full of exotic and wonderful things. So sea captains were under instructions from merchants and collectors to record and purchase anything and everything they thought worth taking home. And sailors commonly increased their wages by hawking foreign artifacts around in addition. It's also a time when the wealthy burghers of Holland had their cabinets of curiosities. They wanted pieces to go into those cabinets. And like the Portuguese, the Dutch were also commissioning items for the European market. This clearly has got absolutely nothing to do with Japan, other than the fact it is covered in maquillé. It's slightly less gaudy than the previous Portuguese and Spanish preference. The geometric mother of pearl inlays have disappeared, and the items became a bit more Japanese in style, with greater areas of black ground. And this basically obviously reflected the Northern European taste of the Dutch, as opposed to the more flamboyant Southern European taste of Spain and Portugal. It's also worth mentioning that the British East India Company also got involved in trading with Japan. Not for long, very brief. Their first voyage to Japan was in 1613, carrying the gift of a telescope for the Shogun, which was actually really quite a valued gift to be giving. But they were also taking, as they took everywhere in the world, a lot of English wool. And no one could really see much point in English wool. If you're sort of in Japan and you're dressed in beautiful silks, what are you going to do with a load of English wool. And in return, the Shogun gave the ship's captain two suits of armor to bring back to UK to be presented to James I. And if you go to the collection that's on show at the Queen's Gallery at the moment, you will see that suit of armor that came over in the early 1600s. But in giving that sort of gift, this introduces another type of collecting, which we'll see occurring again and again, the exchange of gifts between rulers. But I highly recommend the whole gift pact exhibition at the Queen's Gallery if you haven't seen it. It's on at the moment. So lacquer is featuring still as an expression of the highest quality. And in fact, it was last exchanged at the coronation of Queen Elizabeth II, where this magnificent lacquer box was gifted from Emperor Hirohito to Elizabeth II. Also coming back in the cargo in 1614, the East India Company, was a lot of lacquer. It's recorded, it was auctioned off in London, and it is seen as being the first art auction in English history. So again, lacquer played an important part in those early days. Later in the 1600s, by the 1630s, the Dutch were commissioning some spectacular pieces of lacquer to help their trade. They were basically influential gifts that were given to people who they thought could help the Dutch East India Company in its trading and improve and to promote their trading opportunities. This is the so-called Mazarin chest, which you can see in the V&A today. And it's part of the collection of Cardinal Jules Mazarin, a French voracious collector, second only to Louis XIV as a patron of the arts in France in the 17th century. And it's maquillé work of an unusually high standard for export work, which usually was not as high standard as domestic work. And such pieces were not just shipped to Europe, but also as gifts for wealthy classes in Asia. This example here, now known as the Chiddingstone Cabinet, because it's in a collection in Chiddingstone, Kent. But that's the only reason it is given this name, because originally it was gifted to India's Mughal court by the Dutch East India Company. Again, trying to promote trade, trying to promote the Dutch and their business. The popularity of lacquer to royal families became very important. And by the 18th century, no sort of self-respecting aristocratic family would not have at least one lacquer cabinet, like you see in the cabinet in the picture here, standing in their interiors, and often a pair of them. By the end of the 17th century, the Dutch East India Company had ceased trading in lacquer, made the sourcing of lacquer pieces much more difficult even than before. And the Chinese became the sole exporters carrying these pieces to the West. The next country we need to look at is France. By the 18th century, there was a changing taste in European aristocratic interiors, and no longer were they interested in square cabinets that we were looking at there. It was the Rococo, which was becoming the fashion, which is all curves and intense decoration. So this was a very dangerous time for these lacquer cabinets as it came over to Europe. Nobody really wanted them, but they were too valuable just to throw away or discard in some way. And so they became the raw material for adaptation to more contemporary European taste. And French cabinet makers, working for the luxury market again, were taking slices out of these cabinets and reworking them into completely French pieces of furniture, which is an extraordinary sort of sight in many ways. It's got so little now to do with Japan as a place, but everything to do with still the appeal of lacquer and this uniquely Japanese product. So this was the age of chinoiserie. And in chinoiserie, very little distinction was made between anything with Japanese, Chinese. It came from the East, it was chinoiserie. And although it is still using the Japanese subject. It is showing a desire now to improve and turn this object into a customization. And this brings us to another of the great collectors of the 18th century, Marie Antoinette. She formed a very large collection of Japanese lacquer, including quite a few actual Japanese pieces for the first time, as opposed to pieces made for export. I've just been given my 2-minute warning. I'll take note of that. And so what she was doing and what the French were doing, you could take a very beautiful piece of lacquer and you then improve it, put it in a stand. Then you get another piece, get a bit of ormolu mounting on it, stick that in a stand, and hey ho, you've got a piece of French Japanese lacquer. It's very sort of beautiful in its way, but it's got very little to do with Japan. By the end of the 18th century, political upheavals in Europe, these great collections, Marie Antoinette's included, obviously fell and were in the main auctioned off. And the British became one of the key buyers of this because the British had avoided a revolution. And George IV was buying, and you see his pieces around in the Royal Pavilion. But soon they would be able to buy directly from Japan, because in the mid-19th century, Japan opened up. As I think you all know, it was forced to open up by the Americans, and it heralded the collapse of the system of isolation that has sustained for 250 years. And the effect on Japanese society was obviously profound. Virtually overnight, the working lives of all those artists who had been providing for the landed gentry in Japan no longer had a job. And the export market became absolutely essential to the Japanese, essential to establish their credibility, because they'd seen what had happened to China and they certainly didn't want to go that way. But it coincided with the international expositions that were going on at that time, and the Japanese started sending pieces to those. Initially, again, they were appealing to a Western taste, things which they thought would be bought and snapped up in the West. And they were right, they were. But if you look at these, you can see that within them, there was something you can recognize as Japanese, but it's very much dressed up for a Western audience. But as time went on, by the late 19th century, they were being encouraged to take more Japanese-based items to Europe for sale and finding a market. So here we see a piece which came from the Louisiana Exposition in 1904, and we're really now seeing a real piece of Japanese design, the writing table and the suribako, which takes us back to what had been seen by the Portuguese and Spanish 300 years earlier when they first opened up. But for the first time, we are now seeing the Japanese items coming across. It is still going for a very wealthy market. So in summary, I'd just like to say that until the end of the 18th century, it's a prerogative for the rich and powerful. There was the gifting going on between the royal families, but the appeal of lacquer primarily was relying on its medium rather than the objects themselves. I leave you with some contemporary lacquer pieces of what's going on today. Some of the most exciting things in lacquer are now happening in contemporary society. And that, for me as a dealer in lacquer, is the quote I will always hang on to, because I truly believe it. They are the most and perfect finest objects ever issued from the hand of man. And that was from the French critic Louis Gonse in 1900. So thank you. That's a bit of a gallop through, but thank you for your listening.
Thank you very much, Simon. We now move on to the topic of collections and our next speaker. So I'd like to introduce you to Yamada Masami, curator for Japan in the Asian department at the Victoria and Albert Museum. And her responsibilities include Japanese netsuke, lacquerware, and ukiyo-e woodblock prints, amongst others. She contributed extensively to the organization of the V&A's major exhibition, Kimono Kyoto to Catwalk in 2020, and the publication of the accompanying book. Her current area of research is Japanese contemporary craft and design, and particularly the work of contemporary urushi lacquer makers. In her presentation, Masami explores the principles behind the V&A's extensive collections of Japanese art and design, shining a spotlight on several recently acquired contemporary pieces. Please join me in welcoming Yamada Masami.
Thank you, Simon. Good evening, everybody. My name is Masami Yamada. I'm curator of Japanese art at the V&A Museum. So my today's talk is titled Collecting Contemporary Japan, Japanese Art Collections at the V&A. The V&A was established in 1852 with an educational mission to make high quality art and design accessible to people of all social classes. The first director, Henry Cole, declared that museum should be a schoolroom for everyone. In this short talk, I will focus on the museum's Japanese collections, which now are comprising over 48,000 objects in total. Following Simon's talk, I should also mention that we have the most important and extensive collection of Japanese historic lacquerwares outside Japan. By explaining the brief history of the development of our Japanese collections, followed by examples of recent acquisitions, I will demonstrate that collecting contemporary Japanese craft remains central to the V&A's mission today. The V&A was created out of the profits of ticket sales from the 1851 Great Exhibition in the Crystal Palace in London, which attracted over 6 million visitors. This first world fair in human history was entirely devoted to contemporary products from across the world. Although no East Asian country directly took part in this international event, a small selection of Japanese products was exhibited by Chinese art dealers. This was Chinese art dealers from Europe. This was before Japan officially opened its doors to international trade, and so availability of Japanese objects remained fairly limited at this time. However, Japanese objects had first entered the museum collection as early as 1852, the year the V&A was established. They were a group of lacquerwares that you see here on the screen, purchased from William Hewitt of Hewitt & Co., a leading importer of Chinese objects in London. The same company was responsible for the China Court of the 1851 Great Exhibition. European dealers of Chinese objects exhibited their stock in the China Court, and Hewitt Co. was the principal company behind this collaborative effort. As Simon has already demonstrated in his talk, Japanese lacquerwares had captured the imagination of wealthy Europeans for centuries. In case of the V&A, medium lacquer was not a conscious choice for the museum's first Japanese acquisition, but they were selected for their availability and technical relevance to the existing collection of European furniture in the museum. In the following years from the 1860s to 80s, the museum's acquisition concentrated on modern and contemporary works purchased from the World Fairs and European dealers. Although today we look at these objects and think these are historic objects, but when they entered the museum, they were entered as example of the latest crafts from Japan. Japan officially participated in 1867 Exposition Universelle in Paris. The V&A purchased many objects from this particular fair, including the cloisonné kettle on the right, which is known as the earliest recorded example of Japanese cloisonné recorded in the West. Cloisonné enamel was a newly revitalized craft in Japan at the time. While Japan was actively exporting contemporary crafts designed to meet the high Victorian taste, Japanism in Europe was reaching its peak, responding to the sudden influx of Japanese objects into the West. The V&A was already a well-established museum by this time, and a massive cast bronze you see in the middle by Suzuki Chokichi signifies this period of active trade. The V&A's second director, Philip Cunliffe Owen, had to get special permission in order to acquire this monumental object for a huge amount of money. The following decades into the early 20th century saw a number of important donations and bequests of historic works from individual collectors who had formed substantial collections of Japanese objects in the late 19th century, once historic Japanese objects became more easily available in the European market. For example, many of our early inloan and netsuke were donated or bequest from private collection, such as the collection of George Sorting. Nearly 200 inro and over 300 netsuke were bequest to the V&A from his collection in 1910. The earliest dating example of inro in our collection from the 17th century, which you see on the left on the screen, was given to the museum in 1921 by Lillian Emily Sage in memory of her late husband, Edward Sage, who was a collector of Japanese lacquer and employed in the Public Works Department of Indian government and visited Japan around 1890. So now jumping almost 100 years, but it was only in 1970 that the Far Eastern Department, known today as the East Asian section of the Asian Department, was established. Until this moment, everything Chinese, Japanese, and Korean had been looked after by the B&A's material-based departments, such as ceramics, metalwork, and woodwork. The B&A curators in the 20th century before the 1970s had no expertise in Asian languages, no cultural context. This initiative in the 1970s marked a new beginning of collecting Japanese objects. While historic objects were actively added by means of purchase and donation to fill gaps in the collection, a new range of contemporary crafts and products, which you see here on the screen, combining traditional skills with modern aesthetics, were sourced not only from European sellers, but also directly from Japan. The 90s was another crucial period in terms of shaping our Japanese collection and defining our contemporary collecting direction. A groundbreaking exhibition entitled Japanese Studio Crafts, Tradition and the Avant-Garde was held at the V&A in 1995. This exhibition became an opportunity to significantly expand the B&A's Japanese modern and contemporary crafts collection and cemented the museum's position as a leading institution in this field. The Toshiba Gallery of Japanese Art at B&A opened in 1986 as the first permanent gallery of Japanese art in a UK museum. It was also the very first example of a corporate sponsorship in this country. We are extremely fortunate to have had Toshiba's generous support to this day. A dedicated large section for the display of the modern and contemporary in Japan that you see here on the screen opened in Toshiba Gallery in 2015. This was one of the most significant outcomes of the major gallery refurbishment, an upgrade carried out 20 years after the original opening of the gallery. This initiative reflected not only a consensus among the B&A curatorial team, but also audience research result, which had clearly shown that our visitors wanted to see more contemporary Japan in our gallery. A section dedicated to the 20th and 21st centuries had always been regarded as an important feature in the B&A's Japanese gallery. However, the focus was predominantly on studio crafts before the gallery refurbishment in 2015. The images here that you see are from 2011, so only about 10 years ago, but you really clearly see the difference from what we have today. Today, our modern and contemporary section is divided into seven key areas. studio crafts, craft design, design collaboration, personal electronics, kawaii, the culture of cuteness, dress, and graphic art. So far, we have hurried through the key moments in the past 170 years of Japanese contemporary collecting at the V&A. Before closing my talk, I would like to highlight some of our latest studio craft acquisitions, just to show how we approach contemporary collecting today. In 2017, ceramic artist called Masuda Toshiya was commissioned to create his signature pixelated ceramic sculpture modeled from a V&A object. What you see here on the screen is the result of this commission project. Despite Masuda's sculpture's very digital appearance, which is inspired by early computer games, Masuda's piece has been entirely slab built and hand modeled. While Makuzu Kozan's Meiji period masterpiece on the left depicts a family of bear hiding in a cave from an eagle, the contemporary version by Masuda depicts a human family sheltering during a warfare. In today's curatorial practice, we treasure building up relationships with artists, which often create this kind of exciting collaborative opportunity. We are also conscious of promoting the V&A collection as a source of an inspiration for today's artists. Art fairs in London remain an important source of acquisitions for the museum. These two lacquer pieces were both acquired after having been exhibited at London fairs. As Simon mentioned, across the range of Japanese crafts media, it is lacquer that has recently seen the emergence of the most exciting fresh talents. Non-functional sculpture works are becoming increasingly common. And Muramoto Shingo's delicate, beautiful sculpture on the left is one of many examples. When acquiring new objects, their relevance to our existing collection is another key aspect to consider. When we already have an extensive collection in the museum, it is naturally important to find examples which testify continuation of tradition. In case of metalwork, it is Japan's passion for range of mixed metals and base metals widely used for metalworking that has long fascinated the West. And this is one of the reasons why Japanese sword fittings have fascinated Western collectors over the years. Our three recent acquisitions you see here on the screen are all by relatively young artists. Rusu Aki on the right is a woman artist who creates abstract metal sculpture using her chosen medium of iron. Despite the use of hard and cold metal, her work looks incredibly organic. Sako Ryuhei in the middle is specialized in mokumegane, wood grain metal techniques originally developed in the 17th century for decorating sword fittings. Koichi Yo's copper work on the left is shaped by hammering and colored in deep red using traditional coloring process known as niro, boiled color, whereby the metal is heated, treated in a special liquid solution to stain the metal surface. All of these reflect the maker's modern individual aesthetics while celebrating Japan's long tradition of metalworking. Iyo and Sako's pieces will be displayed in V&A's Silver Gallery from next month as part of the special display entitled Metalworking Now, focused on cutting edge examples of contemporary metalwork from around the world. Lastly, holding a major exhibition is always a significant reason for us to expand our contemporary collection. The picture you see here is from the Kimono Kyoto Catwalk exhibition held in 2020. This was the last section of the show dedicated to 21st century kimono fashion. Almost all the kimono you see around the rectory in the middle are contemporary designs newly added to our collection. The exhibition is now touring to Musée de Quai Branly in Paris later this month from November 22nd. I hope many of you will have a chance to visit it. In 1852, the BNA was born with the mission to inspire people of all social classes. Today, we are here to continue the same mission to respond to exciting changes in design practice and technology to inspire our visitors. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Masami. Fascinating talk about the V&A, thank you. So finally, we look at collectors, and I'd like to introduce our third speaker, Rosemary Bandini. Rosemary has been involved in the Japanese art world for over 40 years and now deals privately, specializing in Netsuke and Sagemono. She has written several books on the subject and in 2013 curated the Lone Exhibition in a Nutshell held at the Embassy of Japan here in London. She has organized three Netsuke conventions for the International Netsuke Society, where she is a member of the board. And in her presentation, Rosemary looks at notable collectors of Netsuke throughout history. Please welcome Rosemary Bandini.
Thank you, Simon. I have to say that the exhibition at the Embassy of Japan in 2013 wouldn't have happened if it hadn't been for Simon, who was my guide through the mysteries of working with embassies. Collectors up until the 19th century were really basically composed of the leisured classes whose interests were in classical and ancient civilizations. But by the time the 19th century came along, everything began to change because a whole new section of society was created by the Industrial Revolution and a newly emerging moneyed social class. This was accompanied by international exhibitions such as the Great Exhibition of 1851, but which showed a window onto other civilizations, modern cultures rather than ancient cultures. And so a whole new era of collectors was born. The greatest collector probably of all times when it comes to many things, but including Netsuke, was Augustus Wollaston Franks. He was a precocious child who enjoyed spending his time drawing hieroglyphics, and he engaged in a very intellectual correspondence with an eminent Egyptologist who had no idea at the time that he was a mere child he was writing to. He had, amongst his many interests, he was very fond of Netsuke, and he collected them and loaned them to the British Museum, where he had a post. The British Museum didn't actually want things like this. They wanted, particularly driven by Sir Anthony Panizzi, the keeper of printed books. He made every effort he could to make sure that Franks couldn't add to the collection. So Franks had plenty of money himself, so he bought the things himself. And in the V&A's archives, there are sheafs of paper, sheafs of invoices and receipts for the things he bought. He would buy 20 or 30 Netsuke at a time from the dealers who were based around Regent Street. He obviously enjoyed Japanese art a lot, and he had other followers like Oscar Raphael who worked with him and also spent time in the British Museum studying them with him. And before his death, he bequeathed the collection to the museum. His influence at the British Museum cannot be exaggerated. He modernized it and transformed it, and he's sometimes known as the second father of the British Museum. There was also a growing interest in Japan towards the end of the 19th century, and this Japanese village was established by a Dutch-Japanese translator who had the bright idea of getting 100 people from Japan to come over to London to recreate a Japanese village where they were a sort of living tableau, carrying out their daily life while people came to watch them as a sort of curiosity. It was tremendously popular, but possibly not in the best possible taste. And Punch magazine responded to Louis Wain's edition of drawings of what was going on in Japan from the Japanese village. Punch magazine countered it with an illustration of everyday English life, which certainly is not flattering to the British. And the Japanese government was not very happy about the Japanese village, but nonetheless, it ran for the most part for 2 years and received over 1 million visitors. And it promoted interest in Japan and Japanese life. A typical Edwardian, Victorian Edwardian collector was Edward Gilbertson. He was an assistant to the English artist Thomas Wright and went to Russia with him, but then got involved in a duel where he killed his opponent. And so he had to hotfoot it to Constantinople, where he took up a post at the Ottoman Bank. When he came back to England, he lent some money, and as surety for the loan, he was given 2 ivory okimono. And this was how he first became hooked on Japan. And hooked he was indeed. He learned Japanese. He taught Japanese. He wrote about Japanese art. And in general, greatly promoted it. And typically of 19th century gentlemen, he kept a written record of everything that he bought. This is the frontispiece of a 3-volume monograph where he recorded not only everything he bought, but with photographs and illustrations at the side. This happens to be 2 particularly fine netsuke, a horse by Shigetada and a magnificent shishi by Shigemasa, and a magnificent shishi by Tomotada. Not everything in his monograph is wonderful, though. So there must have been an element of buying everything he was offered. He complained at the end of the 19th century that it was becoming increasingly difficult to find good netsuke. He said, whereas Christie's used to sell them strung together like onions in groups of 7 or 8, you now had to pay more than 3 times the price of 1 string of netsuke to buy one example. And he noted that it was particularly hard to find good wood netsuke by the masters. And in fact, it was only the dispersal of collections formed in the 19th century that released the good pieces onto the market. Somebody who was not a collector, but very instrumental in collecting Japanese art in the UK was Tomita Kumasaku, who came to London as part of a trading company and in 1903 joined Yamanaka and Company and eventually became the head of Yamanaka. In 1915, he organized an exhibition in aid of the Red Cross and the Red Cross's war effort. And this was a major, major event, which again provoked interest amongst collectors. He also went on to become a great friend of Alfred Barr in Geneva and was responsible for most of his choices that are now in the collection. These 2 men are intertwined, so I've put them together. Frederick Meinertshagen came from a well-to-do family, but was disinherited because he married a girl of lower classes, and his fortune of £30,000, he quickly blew on buying Japanese works of art. And so he had no choice but to open a shop where he sold cigarettes alongside netsuke and other curios. He realized that he could never be really a collector of netsuke, so he decided instead to keep pieces for a short time to study them, and he created a card index of every piece he ever saw. And this is now in the British Museum or the British Library as part of the collection. When the Second World War threatened the safety of London, he entrusted his card index to William Winkworth, William Wilberforce Winkworth, who was more or less his contemporary, and obviously trusted Winkworth greatly. And Winkworth hid it in a Quaker community in Somerset, and so it survived the war. And subsequently, a Netsky collector in the end of the 20th century pursued a great project of photographing these cards, and the majority of them are now published in a two-volume book called MCI. Hard to get hold of, but very fascinating. Not only has Meinertzhagen put all his notes in it, but so has Winkworth added his notes to it. Winkworth was a great collector. He worked for a time at the British Museum, where he noted that Japanese art by that time had fallen from grace in favor of Chinese art. And he claimed that although he never found any social snobbery, there was great intellectual snobbery. And he, for his love of Japanese items, was treated as if he were a communist. The Netsky illustrated here is perhaps one of the most famous. It's known as the Meinertzhagen Kirin. And in this picture, Meinertzhagen is admiring it through his loop. It sold towards the end of the 19th century for $1 million. One of my favorite collectors and characters of the 20th century was Anne Hull Grundy. When she was a child, her family escaped Nuremberg and came to settle in England in the 1930s. Her father established the Metoy toy factory. Anne accompanied her parents on a trip to Harrogate, a business trip to Harrogate, where she purchased her first Netsky. Because, as she explained, she was bored in Harrogate and she wanted something to do. She then became one of the greatest collectors of the 19th century, but very unhappily, she contracted sarcoidosis on her honeymoon in Italy and became progressively ill and eventually became bedridden. But such was her command and her personality that the auction rooms, Christie's and Sotheby's, would send entire sales down to Hampshire for her to inspect. She was undoubtedly a notoriously difficult woman. She hated dealers and museum people with equal enthusiasm. She once accused a museum curator of stealing a Netsky from her and hiding it in his trouser turnip so that he could make off with it without her seeing. An unfortunate jewelry dealer who had been to see her was stopped by the police on his way back to London because she phoned up and demanded that the police fetch him back because he'd failed to sell her a piece that she wanted. She was difficult. Here you see in this photograph, she's wearing ermines. She has an ermine bedspread and she has an ermine coat and hood paid for by the sale of her husband's Martin ware. But as well as being difficult, she also was a generous woman. She bought works of art, jewelry, medals, and gave them to provincial museums because she felt everybody was entitled to have beauty in their lives. And also, I know from my own experience, when my late husband went to visit her, she would always send back a toy for my children, or she would, if any one of us was ill, she would send a food parcel, a nutritious food parcel to help us get better. She initially decided towards the end of her life that she would, like her young life, she would donate her collection, and she offered it to the Victoria and Albert Museum. However, after a mere fortnight, they had failed to exhibit it, and so she took it all back again and gave it to the British Museum, who were already forewarned of what the procedure was with her, and they held a huge exhibition in the 1980s of her love jewelry collection, which she had formed with her husband, and of her Netsky. And the proviso was that they would always be on display. And a section of the collection is always on display, but of course not the entire collection, which was very large. I miss Mrs. Grundy because she was one of the great eccentrics and one of the great drivers of collecting. She wrote many articles about Netsky, and we owe her a lot, as well as recognizing that her behavior could be extremely difficult. This is one of her Netsky in the British Museum I particularly like. It's a two-part, the skeleton done in metal and the back of the skeleton made from stag antler. Edward Addison Wrangham, always known to everybody as Ted. His mother died when he was 5 years old and he was sent to Wharfdale to live with his aunt. His uncle, maternal grandfather was one of the great English collectors of Chinese ceramics. And on one occasion when Ted as a young boy was staying with his grandfather, an entire auction sale that his grandfather had bought was delivered. So Ted helped him unpack everything. And amongst the china, he found a small box of Netsky. And in that box, there was an ivory piece of Shoki, the demon queller with a little oni struggling out of his grasp. It amused the child very much. And so his grandfather gave it to him. And that Netsky stayed in Ted's pocket for the rest of his childhood, jingling around with bits of string and sealing wax and the sort of things that a boy carries in his pocket. Ted would sometimes get on his bicycle and cycle over to Harrogate, a 15-mile ride, and go to Blairman and Sons, where they allowed him in and were very courteous to him, let him rummage amongst their collection, ask questions, and eventually buy something with his pocket money to take back home again. And when he went to Eton, he continued to wander around the antique shops looking for pipe cases or Netsky to buy to add to his collection. But when he went to university, he took up mountaineering instead and became a very, very well-respected mountaineer who narrowly missed out on the Everest expedition. But at one point, he had a very near miss with death when he slipped from a rock, and only because his companion, who was tied to him for safety, threw himself off the other side of the rock did Ted survive. And he realized at this time that he was by now a married man with children, that he couldn't continue the risky pursuit. So he went back to collecting. He amassed a huge collection, which was dispersed by Bonhams a few years ago in a series of sales. But when I was interviewing him once, I said, how many Netsky do you need to be a collector? And he promptly replied, 3, 1 to keep and 2 to swap. But not all Netsky collectors were financially as well off as the people we've looked at so far. Gabor Wilhelm was a Hungarian who left Hungary at the outbreak of the Second World War and eventually ended up in Paris with his 2 companions. He was still a very young man. He still reminisces about sleeping under bridges or the huge joy of finding a suitably safe tunnel in the banks of the Seine that he could sleep in safely and wake up in the morning looking at the dawn over Paris. He eventually got a job repairing typewriters, and so he was able to take a room in a boarding house where he met his wife. He can't remember anymore how he first became interested in Japanese art. He is 96 now, but he says every Saturday morning for 70 years, he would be at the Marché aux Puces at 7 o'clock in the morning, and soon became known by the dealers in Japanese art who always saved things for him. And so in the course of his life, he amassed an extremely interesting and varied collection with some great works of art included in it. Here I've just illustrated 2 pieces, 2 unusual pieces carved from shell, mother of pearl or abalone. Gabor finally dispersed his collection earlier this year. And so other people were able to take a little piece. Collectors love to have a piece that's been in the collection of another great collector. It gives it a cachet, a sense of continuance. Lastly, Sem Jalal. Sem Jalal came to the UK when he was 2 years old with his family from Cyprus. They worked hard in the clothing industry. And Sem had quite a lonely childhood, but he became very interested in fish and aquaria. And as a young man, he went up to visit a koi collector in the north of England. And while he was there, the koi collector insisted on showing him his Netzke collection. Among them was a Netzke of a fisher girl struggling with an octopus. 4 weeks later, Sem found himself in Harrogate, back at Mr. Blairman's. And there to look at watches, he instead spotted in the corner a Netzke of an octopus with fish. And a few minutes later, he left Blairman's with the Netzke, with his first Netzke purchase and £450 lighter in his pocket. Again, he came to London. He didn't have the same success with London dealers who preferred to stick to their established clients and weren't very keen on selling Netzke to a casually dressed man with the wrong accent. So Sem decided that he had to do it on his own, and so he did. Swapping and trading Netzke and traveling all over the world, he has ended up by owning one of the finest collections of Netzke ever formed. Here he's pictured with another collector at the Bohr Collection in Geneva studying Netzke. He particularly favored this type of Netzke because he felt that these plump and fierce looking Oni rather reflected him. And so it became his passion. Augustus Franks referred to collecting as an hereditary illness for which he was afraid there was no cure. And that seems to be the way it is with dedicated collectors. The golden age of collecting was undoubtedly the 19th to mid 20th century, but the collecting gene has never died and it persists, and the passion and dedication to collecting is alive and well throughout the world, which is always evident by the number of people who turn up to our biennial Netzke collectors conventions held throughout the world. So that's a very brief overview of Netzke collectors. Each one of these people could have a book written by them, so I'm afraid it was really a romp through history, but I hope it gives you an idea of a collector and how sharing a passion and the community that is involved in collecting, how it grows and continues to exist to this day. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We are running slightly over time, so I'm going to be very strict and only restricted to two questions, but we will have time afterwards to meet our speakers. Please do, if you could join us, please, Simon, Masami, and Rosemary. Is there any questions that you would like to ask just now? If you would, put your hand up and we will get a microphone to you. I can't believe that. We have one question. We have one gentleman. If you could keep your hand up, please, sir. And we'll have a microphone. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you.
Thanks for the talks. Just out of curiosity, are you seeing younger collectors coming in and collecting some of these pieces more? Or, because as I understand, there might have been a dry spell for some time. And so essentially, are you seeing younger collectors come in, and has the dynamics and the age and demographics collectors changed probably in the last decade?
There are certainly young collectors. I don't know if Simon finds the same. There are young collectors. Money is always a factor, and younger people tend to have less money until they've got young families and they they have other expenses in the beginnings of their adult life. But yes, we do. We even have schoolboy collectors. So yes, it does continue. And I think it's actually, in the case of Netsky, it's that fascination with the stories, the history, the whole culture that is encapsulated in a tiny little thing that you can hold in your hand. So yes, definitely we do have young collectors, thankfully.
I think there's a distinction also being made as what actually constitutes a collector. I mean, certainly in my business, I have young clients, but they will probably buy one or two spectacular pieces for their homes to just enhance their way of living, as opposed to buying multiple pieces and forming what we might think of as a collection of a particular thing. I think it's about beauty and about value of quality of life that they are looking for. And it's part of a family thing that they want to have.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your question. I'm sorry if we're having some problems maybe with your microphone, Simon. I'm not sure if you could maybe...
With mine. Up a little bit. I've done something.
If we could have... yes, we have a question for a gentleman right at the back. If you could keep your hand up, sir, so we can see, and wait until the microphone comes to you. Thank you very much.
Just learning that Japanese collectibles that you've spoke about tonight, much of it was exportware, and I think of Chinese exportware as well. And exportware typically doesn't have the collectability that other forms of craft and art have. And it makes me think of the Republic period in China, where there was a reversion to something that was more domestically orientated. Is there a similar parallel in Japan? Or have I made incorrect assumptions?
I didn't hear the question very well.
Could you just possibly rephrase the question? I mean, I think you're absolutely right that it was exportware, and basically it didn't necessarily reflect what was going on in Japan. I think what we're seeing now is a far greater interest in Japanese design, which has become international, really. It's no longer a curiosity. It's something which has joined the international grouping of artists. I mean, it's a slight diversion. I think it was interesting when Japan modernized that dialogues were possible to be had between Japanese ceramicists or metalworkers or graphic artists, because they could speak to their equivalent in the West, whereas this was not a luxury that the lacquerists had at all, because there was no Western lacquer tradition. And so they inevitably became more isolated than the other mediums.
I think you need to separate. I mean, there is the Japanese aesthetic, which continues and is much admired to this day. And we've seen things which Masami has shown at the Victorian Albert Museum that show our admiration for the Japanese aesthetic. When Netsky were concerned, when, as Simon said, when Japan opened up to the West, everybody lost their traditional work, and the Japanese government actively encouraged anybody with a knife to whittle a Netsky to sell to the unsuspecting British who thought British and French. I mean, there was a chap called there were two brothers, the Sichel in Paris, who wrote a book of their wanderings in Japan and claimed that they were robbing Japan of its culture, whereas the Japanese were certainly not selling their culture. They were selling their tat to the traders who were going there and shipping them back by the chestload. And certainly at that time, late 19th century, early 20th century, where Netsky concerned, some much less high quality pieces were reaching Europe. So
I think that's a very important distinction. I mentioned when Japan was opened up, it didn't want to suffer the fate of China. It had seen the West come in and pull out virtually anything they wanted. And that happened to a lot of colonized countries, as we know. It never happened to Japan. Japan very early on both saw the value of their art to be an international currency, but also were very closely controlled in what they allowed out of the country. So there's no equivalent to an army moving in and just sweeping up what it wants and bringing it back to the West. That never happened with Japan. And I think, as Rosemary's alluding to, for many Japanese, they think the best stuff has never really left their country.
Yeah. Except you will find it maybe in our exhibition. If I understand your question correctly, what we have are Netsuke on show, for example, as one example of some of the things which were from the Edo period, were used as Netsuke rather than as trinkets to be sold for the export market. So please do not forget to visit our exhibition, which will be open late tonight as well. I am going to be strict and stop us there, but I wanted to say, if I understand your question correctly, to Masami maybe, are we seeing domestic collecting of contemporary craft work, for example? Are we seeing the collections that you have in the V&A also collected in Japan? Or is it something which is collected outside Japan more?
You mean the contemporary?
Contemporary.
Today's contemporary craft. Well, that's a very good question. Well, I would say yes in Japan as well, because what, you know, I showed us recent acquisitions, the same artists are actively exhibiting, more actively in Japan, really. And what we are trying to do, really, what I'm trying to do at the V&A is, because some artists are represented by commercial galleries internationally, so you get to see their names more, perhaps. But there are lots of artists in Japan who are really making exciting new types of crafts. For example, in case of lacquer, I showed one of the lacquer sculpture, but there are lots more artists whose name have never been really introduced to the West. So it is happening in Japan as well, which is very exciting. So.
Good to know. Thank you. Thank you very much. I am going to have to stop us here. I have a few. Please do join me in thanking Simon Pilling, Yamada Masami, and Rosemary Bandini. Thank you so much. There will be an opportunity for people to speak to you later, I know. Thank you to our event partner, Asian Art in London. Thank you very much indeed for helping us with this. And thank you all to everybody here in the hall and also online. If you'd like to listen to today's talk again, a recording of the event will be archived on Japan House's YouTube, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter platforms. And following today's event, we will send a simple feedback form by email. We'd be grateful if you could fill that in, as it will help us in the future. If you will bear with me just a few minutes, I mean moments later, and indulge me just to show, Simon, could I ask you to maybe move that side so that... We have the display, Art of Collecting Japan, which of course we are partnering with Asian Art in London. That's upstairs. Please do feel free to have a look at that. Our exhibition with some notable pieces from Takayama, which you can see after this talk, the Carpenter's Line Woodworking Heritage in Hida Takayama. We also have demonstrations using the Carpenter's Line. That's coming up on the 12th and 13th of November here at Japan House. We have our guests arriving from Takayama for that. We also have preserving cultural heritage in Hida Takayama with Ushimaru Takahiko, who looks after cultural heritage preservation in Takayama City in Gifu Prefecture. We will have a gallery talk as well about the Carpenter's Line. So please do look out on our website for various pieces for that. Thank you very much once again, and join me in thanking our three speakers today. Thank you so much.